What is up, everybody? I hope you guys had a wonderful Thursday. Can't believe how fast this week flew by. Crazy to me. Hope you guys have something nice planned for Mother's Day. But before you hit that day, let's get through Friday, right? So we got to do one more working day. So last night I had made a really, really cool video, and boom, when it uploaded, blocked. I was like, you son of a bitch. So I decided to go ahead and finish off the story about the Navy SEAL who turned transgender and then transitioned back to a man. And that's a very controversial topic right now in the nation. Everybody has their opinion on it. But, you know, he talked about just the cancel culture that is, you know, has been arising. If you're not with that flow, then all of a sudden, you know, if you're a prominent figure in the public light and you go against basically anything, they're ready to grill and roast your ass. That's why it worries me so much when I see somebody as wholesome like Keanu Reeves. It always worries me because there's somebody out there that is just trying to look so hard to find dirt on him. Because what does the American people love more than building people up and seeing these wonderful stories about a person like Keanu Reeves? And there's many other actors, actresses, famous people who, you know, are just as kind, just as sweet. And what is the best thing to do to get the America's attention? What's the best thing to do for publicity is for dirty laundry to be aired out. That's why so many people were enamored with the Amber Heard and Johnny Depp trial, because Johnny Depp's having to talk about his coke addiction. I don't know if he still does or doesn't, but it's besides the point. Some of the nasty shit she did, allegedly. But, you know, I hate seeing people get torn down. So with one of the artists that I'm featuring, she had started off great. She was like America's sweetheart when it came to singers. You know, everybody always says Julia Roberts was like America's sweetheart when she was, you know, when she first started off actress, becoming an actress. This is the singer version of her. And just how tumultuous her life got towards the end, and what was allegedly being said about her in public, and then her just sadly passing away. One of the greatest voices of all time. So bringing people down seems to be a lot better for the public view than seeing people built up like a Keanu Reeves. That's why I use that as an analogy. So I'm hoping this cancel culture and all this bullshit ends one of these days. And it's sad that the generation that would be my children, even though I had a child late in life, later, much later than most people, at 40 years old. I was actually more like 38. I was 38 years old when she was born. But the generation right after mine, all of a sudden just, I don't even want to bash a generation because then I get people talking shit about that. But it's just, it's not, you lose the competitiveness of wanting to give everybody a participation ribbon. I'm going to stop right there because I could go on with this all night. But anyways, yeah, so my music video got blocked of my favorite singers, different genres, and so that's what I'm going to be playing. If I pause it, I absolutely apologize, but because of that stupid block, I'm going to have to pause it at certain intervals, and I'll just talk about certain things that I look for and listen for that really makes it good to me, what makes the song great to me. And I'll start off here because I paused one part. So one thing that has always impressed me about the whole music making process, if you were to take a notepad from what an artist is writing and getting ready to perform, whether singing or rapping, and just read it, it doesn't sound really all that impressive. So if I were to just read this from one of the lines, I've been in love and lost to my senses, spinning through the town. Sooner or later, the fever ends and I wind up feeling down. I need a man who will take a chance on a love that burns hot enough to last. That is just as if I were reading a book. What an artist is able to do is to take these words and make them into something truly special, truly amazing. And that's why I loved and love music so much, and that's why I strived and did everything I could to get into the music industry. And when that dream came true, I was so fucking happy because I got to see, you know, these artists make these songs, when I'm looking at their lyrics, I'm like, this kind of sounds, you know, dumb or whatever. But when they did it, not being the biggest fan of hip hop, I'm like, damn, that was actually a lot better than what it came, you know, from what I was reading. And it's all about the way they approach the certain choruses, the way they enunciate things. I'll leave it off with this and then we'll go ahead and get this started. But there was a cool video that I had seen of Anderson Cooper interviewing Eminem. And there's words that don't rhyme. Orange, purple, silver. There's another one or a couple more. And Eminem said, and mind you, I'm a late fan of Eminem's. Like, I only started liking him like this past maybe 3-4 years. But I appreciate his mind and what he does and what he's able to do that a lot of other people can't do. And the fact that he always pays homage to those that influenced him, I think, is just, it's awesome. You know, too many people have such big egos nowadays that very rarely will they say, like, man, you know, mention them almost every single song. And that's what he does. And I think that gains him a lot of respect from the old timers who say, you know, I don't give a shit about his color. Shit, the dude could rap and do it better than, you know, most people. So they're automatically going to hate on him. But how he's able to do double entendres, how he's able to enunciate certain words. So when, you know, he brought up the fact that it bothered him that there was nothing that rhymed with orange. And he's like, well, think about how you can enunciate a word to make it rhyme. So he took the word porridge. Like orange porridge. God damn. See, that's an artist thinking. Because it's more than likely the little things like that are eating up, you know, eating him up inside. Like, oh, I got to make this work somehow. I'm going to make this work. And he found a way. So I respect that art form. So with all my talking and all that being said, this is the first artist of the evening. Has a lot to do with the producing. The producer picks such cool ways to begin it, high, down, low, you name it. I mean, great producer on the album on this particular song. What I love is how effortlessly she sang. I mean, if you ever, like when she did the Star Spangled Banner, it looked like she was hardly even trying. She wasn't sitting there gripping, you know, the mic with both hands. She wasn't, you know, like keeping her eyes closed and concentrating. I mean, she just went up there and fucking killed it. Like, I always thought, like, did she even practice? Like, you know, warm up her voice or anything? I mean, more than likely she did. Still considered to this day probably the greatest national anthem rendition from any vocal artist ever. I wonder, has Mariah Carey ever sang the national anthem? Because I have a feeling she would do really, really well. But again, I apologize for ruining the flow of these songs. I'm going to have to pause it, talk, interject, say certain things here and there just to see if it'll get passed through. So I know it ruins the vibe of the song, but let's continue on to the next portion of this. That's what I was reading at the beginning, like if it were a book. Sooner or later, the fever ends and I wind up feeling down. The way she sings it is just, doesn't it sound much better than if you were reading it like a book? Because it sure as shit does to me. But again, what, I'm sure many of you guys know who are music fans. You've seen it 100 times before, whether you came here from Scary Pool Party People, who's Alejandro Aranda, if you came here from other artists that you like. When you see them recording in the studios, you're going to see on one of the, you know, usually it's connected to the mixing board, you're going to see a screen which, you know, has all your notes. And what they're going to do is, you're going to do those notes, you're going to sing your verses a couple of times until they find what they feel is the best one. Okay, you stop right there. Give you a little bit of break. Give your voice a little break. Go back in the recording booth. Do it again, just like you did on this take. And so then they're gonna, what they're gonna see is, they're gonna overlap it to see how closely it matches with your first time around. And it could take 20 minutes, I've seen it take as long as 5 hours to get it to sound and match just right. So if you really, really listen to it, and you could tell a lot better when you're in the studio and you have studio headphones on, like real studio headphones, I'm talking about the ones that are like a couple $1,000, you know, and you're really listening to it, you can hear the reverb from their singing. It's almost the best way I describe it is on your stereo, when you push, you know, certain settings, it has what they call, you know, hall. Like we were singing in a hall sound, you know, just using the acoustics of a hall. You hear that echo and it's a lot more prominent. But when you hear it being sung, it's much harder to pick up until you listen through, you know, real expensive headphones. But if you pay attention to her singing, it's not 1,000% perfect. It's like, you know, 99.9999% perfect. You could still hear a slight reverb. That's what I absolutely love. That's what they look for. Great. Absolutely great to me. Later, the fever ends, and I wind up feeling down. instant chills, man. Every time I hear this freaking song, man, instant chills. Absolutely love this song, her breakout song. Since then, she went on to have such a magnificent career. Sad that we lost her. Still feels like way too soon, even though I know, you know, it all comes to us eventually. But man, just what a gift to, you know, the music industry. That's what she definitely was. So, without dwelling on too much negativity, let's go on to another great singer. Like I said, no particular order. This is just another singer or band that I admire. So, here we go. Here is my next singer, Mariah Carey. Are you team Mariah or team Whitney? That's what I was thinking about earlier. I knew there was that debate back in the day. They both sing absolutely beautifully. You know, the thing about with Mariah Carey is, you know, most sopranos hit like, you know, a C4 type of note. I mean, she is known to go... No, excuse me. I said that wrong. They're around that G, about a G7 is what she's known for doing. Most sopranos, you know, are doing what? About a C or so. And she's doing 4 octaves above that when she really hits those high notes. And that is, not a lot of people are going to have the cojones to try that out without looking foolish. I mean, it is just insane, her vocal range. You know, the difference between them two, I really can't see it because they were both so fucking good. It's just that Mariah had, you know, more longevity. And I know, you know, she still tries to sing. It's just, you know, with age, things kind of, you know, dissipate and go away. But, I mean, man, I loved this song when this came out. One of her first songs, not one of her first songs, but one of her first, you know, big hits, bigger hits. When she started to, you know, put herself on the map. And, you know, this was a Mariah that I had a crush on growing up. The Mariah now, like, she seems too mean. So, this is Mariah Carey's Always Be My Baby. And I can't remember who produced it. Shit. I knew the producer. I met him before. Damn it, what's his name? Anyways, here it is. Just played the music video. Shit. I know it's more than likely gonna get canceled. Oh my god. Here, let me fix this up here real quick. So, 55 seconds. Dang it. Let's see if we can do this here. I was just going back to my whole crush on her back in the day and wasn't paying attention. And it seemed everlasting that you would always be mine. Now you wanna be free. How do you hit that note, man? Christ's sake. Jermaine Dupri, Manuel Seal. The producers, Jermaine Dupri. That's who it was. All of our music for the record label, the first record label I worked for, was all south. It was all down south. Atlanta. And Jermaine Dupri was a big... big down south, you know, cat. I knew it was him because I had met him a couple of times, but I knew it was him. I didn't know he wrote the song though as well. I knew he produced it. I just couldn't think of his name at the time. But I think this is when she was married to, what was his name, Tony Mottola? Because I had noticed a wedding ring on her finger. But yeah, Billionaire. Yeah, that's crazy. This released in 1996, so I was 16 years old. So yeah, this was my Mariah Carey crush days for sure. But yep, good old Jermaine Dupri. He was a big writer in the industry. And he's still going strong. Not just the rap game. Oh yeah, he did marry Janet Jackson. I forgot about that. Huh. Who else did he help out? Criss Cross. I never met them. I met Usher. I'm proud of him, man. I never had anything wrong against him. Like, I always thought he was talented. You know, his rapping wasn't the best, but now that I know he wrote this, that's pretty badass. Like I said, I knew he produced it. I just couldn't think of his name. I didn't know he wrote it, though. So her as an artist taking down what he's writing and turning it into her own style, that skill, again, that's an artist at their best. And that's what she did.
I ain't gonna cry, no, and I won't beg you to stay. If you're determined to leave, boy, I will not stand in your way.
Can I just point out the enunciation of that? If you're to read it, if you're determined to leave, boy, I will not stand in your way, but inevitably you'll be back again. Read that like a book. Doesn't really stand out, but her enunciation of the word inevitably, perfect for this song.
And I won't beg you to stay. If you're determined to leave, boy, I will not stand in your way. But inevitably, you'll be back again. Cause you know in your heart, babe, our love will never end, no.
You'll always be a part of me.
The funny thing too is, just to kind of go back to Jermaine Dupri writing her songs, when you have a writer and then you have an artist, to hear them kind of battle it out on how they want the song to sound is kind of funny, because the artist, you know, inevitably, and I just said that as a pun, you know, wants it to sound a specific way because that's their voice on the track. And of course the producer wants it to sound a certain way because that's their career on the track. Usually 9 times out of 10, unless you're like a Jermaine Dupri or a really well-established, you know, producer like Timbaland, Jay-Z, freaking, oh God, I can't even stand him, but Kanye, you know, that's also their name on the line as well. So to hear when you have, you know, when you have an artist and a producer like, no, you know, this is how it's supposed to sound. It's supposed to sound like this. No, you're supposed to do this right here. You're supposed to do that right there. Tempers flare. Have to wait like a couple hours till the artist wants to get back in the freaking booth. You're wasting your damn time just sitting there. I'm like, man, if I wasn't getting paid for this shit, I'd be pissed. That's how I used to feel. Sorry, guys. My finger hit a button. Where were we? All right, there with the inevitably part. There we go.
Be my baby. Little bit colder, oh,
I know that
you'll be right back.
best, to me, what I consider the best part of this song is the ending. Just the way, you know how they say, to a good movie you need a phenomenal ending, to a good song you need a phenomenal finish, and she closes it out, she kills it. Beautiful voice. So that's a good start, right? Two great, wonderful, freaking female artists, I mean, that are just amazing in every way. So let's go on to the next, shall we? So I told you I was going to be pulling some surprises. Wasn't going to be all the same genre of music. This guy, what is it, Joe Elliott? I think that is his name. I know it's his name. One of the best rock and roll singers. And I know at just about every club that I used to go to back in the day, I haven't been in a club in over 20 years, thank God. When you're working in the entertainment industry, you would get fucking sick of clubs in a heartbeat. And being 40 years old, you especially don't want to be in no club. I'm not trying to run after no 16, or not even 16, 18-year-old girls. That's too young for me. Shit. It's not me. I'm not going to do it. But used to hear this song play all the time. Or another one, actually. Called Pour Some Sugar on Me. So, since I already gave away the artist, I think you guys know who I'm talking about. Phenomenal voice. Their drummer has one arm, which is just extremely fascinating that he's still can jam out better than people with two functional arms, even though his setup I know is specially designed for him. He can still jam out, but this is one of my favorite songs by them, and his smooth voice, man, perfect for this type of music. So here we go with Def Leppard, Photograph, one of my favorite songs. Able to hold those notes and very steady as well, which is hard to do with rock music because you have so much going on. You know, two guitarists, usually, you know, bassist, drummer, you have a lot going on, and that's dependent on how you're singing the song. So to hold that note so you're not throwing off the rest of the guys in the group, you know, having to either speed up their playing, slow it down. I mean, he just holds those notes absolutely perfectly. And unfortunately, I've never got to see a recording of, you know, rock music, you know, the process in which they do it, how they do it, given, you know, the space requirements for the drums, you know, how they bring it all together. Because I know the drums will probably play solo, the guitarist will probably play solo, and then the, you know, the producer and the mixing and, you know, the mastering of the song will all come together through editing. And I wish I always had a chance to see a rock song like this being made. Never had the opportunity to, but the vocals on it, man, he just, like I said, he's a killer. He kills this song every time. Of course, when you're listening to it on repeat, it's going to be the same. But every time I hear him sing it, he still got it. Before we hit this part, this is a climax of, I mean, it's still not the range of his whole voice, man. This dude could go for days, but every time he transitioned, it's a smooth transition, and not a lot of artists are able to make that. You'll hear a lot of the times a lot of edits when an artist has trouble, you know, transitioning to a different type of sound that's going to be, needed for, a certain type of tempo. The tempos are going to be right now. I believe the drums stop. The guitar picks up more like a solo. So it's just going to be him and the guitar and the bassist while he's holding this note going insanely high. You know, there's a lot of artists who just can't do that transition so smoothly. So they'll usually cut in something with, backup singers or somebody, doing something different as far as instrument goes. But when you have this kind of vocal range, he's able just to do it with ease. So going into the climax of, like I said, of his voice, just take a listen. It's great. Are they in the hall? So there's Def Leppard's Photograph. Absolutely love this song. I could jam to this all day and night. Believe me, I have. Summertime, I'll be cruising with the windows down with this song on full blast. I don't care if kids are looking at me. Like high school kids, I see the adults over there freaking air drumming and shit, just getting down, doing the head bop, like they're head banging. Man, nostalgic. I was only 5 years old when this came out, or six or seven, somewhere around there. But remember, I have a 9 year old brother who's 9 years older than me. So there I was, five, six, and he was, either 15, 16. So this was his generations of music. So this, Metallica, Motley Crue, Guns N' Roses, Van Halen, of course, Def Leppard. I mean, the list can go on and on. So I grew up off of this type of music, and that's why I say I had such a time adjusting to rap, because it just wasn't my thing. Like Grandmaster Flash, from the East Coast. I mean, don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. I mean, you listen to that now, that's more like pop. But that's actually what we have a lot to be thankful for the influence for those of you hip-hop lovers. So, yeah, thank you, Grandmaster Flash, because you killed it, man. You killed it with that song, and that paved the way for artists like LL Cool J. I mean, if that song never came around, LL Cool J basically brought it into the masses, into the mainstreams, to where it was more acceptable, and it was starting to play on MTV. Before that, you had, Billy Idol, which I'm not talking shit about Billy Idol. Billy Idol's great. But MTV just was never going to play hip-hop until, you had somebody like LL Cool J. Come on. He killed it. And, you look it up, that's one of Eminem's biggest idols. So You know the dude was talented. Anyways, let's go on to the next. So this right here is one of the toughest songs to get played because they are so extremely against, the whole Napster movement. And for you younglings out there who don't know what Napster is, that paved the way for you guys being able to listen to YouTube, songs on YouTube. Napster was a file-to-file sharing platform to where you mostly got viruses before you got songs. Only one person in the history that I know of got convicted for the downloading of free songs. Some of the bands that were really against it were Metallica, Lars Ulrich, who's the drummer and founder of Metallica, hated it. I know Blink-182 didn't like it. Guns N' Roses. There were a lot of bands that hated it. But, to me, it was cool at the time. But like I said, every time you were on there, you always ran the risk of, I'm going to get a virus. And sure as shit, I think Napster really helped McAfee. I know you guys probably know the story about John McAfee. I think that's his first name, John. But, when you're file-to-file sharing with somebody, which is like crazy nowadays, unless you have some type of VPN, it was crazy back then. It's crazy now, but when you heard your favorite song play, you're like, let me see if somebody else out there has this song, on their hard drive. Peer-to-peer sharing, file-to-file sharing. Sometimes it went through just fine. I think I had maybe like 18, 20 songs or so. Like, I used to be the type of person that would walk into Blockbuster Music. I know you guys might remember that. And buy singles. You remember how they used to sell the singles of certain songs that came out when you didn't want to buy the whole album? That was me, buying the singles. Just came in a little plain cardboard box, wrapped around the CD. I was like, yep, this is my shit. This is my jam. I'm going to do this. So, let's see if this allows me to play it through. Because to me, this guy has one of the greatest voices I've ever heard, bar none. And I mean, he's a legend, but I also heard he has a big head. Mind you, to talk shit about somebody isn't appropriate. They're not here to defend themselves. So, just from what I heard that he could be an asshole. That's why him and his band broke up a couple of times and then they reunited. But, he had the talent to act like an asshole and has the talent that he could have walked away whenever he wanted, which causes strife in any type of band. So, next song, I think you guys will know who it is when you hear it. Could hear that enunciation of those words. He did it so smoothly, like you could barely even tell. But if I were to read it, and you for me, every road leads to your door, every step I take forevermore. The way he sings it and the way he enunciates it, perfect. Not sent. CET, Karate Kid. Do you? first time I had did this video before it got blocked, I made a big deal about this part because I absolutely love the way the editor put that in. He has him sing the first verse saying, "I can't go on." He has him singing it out. So basically, singing a longer verse of "I can't go on" while mixing in his voice, so overlay in it. So the first portion of him saying "I can't go on" is him holding that chord and then again saying "I can't go on." I think it melts perfectly. Love this song. "Will You Still Love Me" by Chicago before he went solo. Excellent, excellent song. One of the best voices in the music industry by far, in my opinion. Just listen to a lot of his songs. I mean, he does it so effing effortlessly that it's just, yeah, it's a shame. So, let's go on to the next, shall we? Some of you guys might be wondering why I picked this, and there's a good reason behind it. They had such a unique sound. He had such a unique sound that his song, their song charted pretty damn well. And I really believe it's because he has a unique way of singing. This is more modern, I would say 2012-ish, somewhere around there. And I remember when the song came out, like, a lot of people loved it. A lot of people were jamming it out. And for good reason. It's a good song. The lyrics are good. But just the way he sings it was a different sound that, you know, the same way, I'm not saying they had the same effect like Nirvana or other groups like that, but just his sound was unique. And so this is a song I'm talking about here. The Killers, Mr. Brightside. Coming out of my cage and I've been doing just fine. And it's not like he's hitting any high notes right now. It's not like he's holding on to these high notes. I mean, I wouldn't even consider him a soprano. It's just the way he sings it, again, is very effortlessly and unique compared to a lot of the singers around this era. Jealousy, turning snakes into the sea, swimming through sick love. Remember, I said phenomenal voices and uniqueness. He has a uniqueness to him. Again, it's effortless. It's downright beautiful. And yeah, I mean, a great, great song. I don't know what else to say about him. I mean, I got to be honest, I haven't heard very many of, you know, other songs of theirs. Just because I would usually when I get stuck on one song, like that's on constant repeat. That was the same with him. But this song, like I said, he doesn't necessarily display all his vocals, but he does enough that it's just wow. That's who made it. I'm not calling her that. But, yeah. Love the uniqueness of his voice. The way he... I hope he sung the lyrics. Or wrote the lyrics. Yeah. The song and lyrics by The Killers, Mr. Brightside. It's an absolutely beautiful song. And... when I first heard it, I was like, God, how many times have I found myself in that exact same position that he's singing about? And the video holds such sentimental value because it does show somebody who's in love who sees this girl, you know, going off with different men. And it's like, you know, it's killing him. And yeah, when it came out, I'm like, oh, my God, this is why I love this song so much. So, yeah, there's another great one. So let's move on to the next couple and... hopefully they won't block this one. So here we go. So many of you guys might not know this next band. They happen to be my favorite band. I think they're pretty much tied up there with Blink-182. I'm hard-pressed to ever find a song on any album that they make. They're that good to me. During the filming of this, they were locked down during COVID, and so they made this out of their, out of one of their homes or apartments or studios. One of the properties that they own. And I had played a while back an acoustic version of what they did. So just think of MTV Unplugged. And Jordan is the lead singer. He has such a fucking amazing voice. I mean, a cappella or not, I mean, the dude just can kill it. So this song is called Heaven Sent. Since there's no... since it's the music video, I'm really going to have to just switch back to a black screen. I'll show a little bit of the music video, but I know, you know, it'll be difficult to get it to play without getting striked. So here we go, guys. Absolutely love that. You're half insane. The way, I mean, his voice, the way he's able to bring it up, back down, the transition is just, it's perfect. I can't get over it. Every time I listen to music and I break it down like this, I'm just become more of a fan than anything. I'm literally at a loss for words because it brings me back to, you know, really sitting there in the studio and then just watching on the monitors and then listening to them sing and like being just wowed. Like, I have no idea what to fucking say right now. But when he does that part, that just, yeah, that gets me every time. So I'm going to rewind that part because he did put a lot of emphasis on that last go around. But what I love about them is a lot of their songs have to do with falling in love, you know, when you're young, you know, in and out of love, being used by girls, all of the above songs that kind of resonate across that. And this is a prime example of that. Just talking about, you know, how he fell in love and this girl is like, you know, she's like heaven sent. And we can all connect with love songs. And I think that's why almost every single song you always hear is about love. It's about falling in love. It's one of the most ridiculously wonderful and greatest feelings that you could have when you fall in love with somebody. And the self-expression in music is just phenomenal, especially from, you know, their point of view. In the way they express themselves. But let me back up before you hit that big note. Okay, so let's get back to where he's about to hit that big note. You're an angel in disguise. I won't expose your wings. Cause you're heaven. The cool thing about them, they've been together for over 20 years. So they have came out around the same time as Blink 182. Blink 182 just, you know, hit it a lot bigger than them. They still, I mean, you know, 1.31 million subscribers. This particular video at 270,000 views. Not the biggest numbers for a band as big as them. You know, this one, 830,000 views, 134. But I know, like, probably their biggest song, My Friends Over You, had, Jesus Christ, like this one right here, Newfound Glory, Vicious Love, featuring Hayley Williams from Paramore, 8.2 million. So they do have a lot of fans. And there's cops passing by or an ambulance. Something must have happened somewhere around this neighborhood because there were like five cop cars, one after the other after the other. So hope everyone's okay, but shit. So yeah, let's finish this off.
Take you away from me.
that video because this will go on for about another almost nearly a minute of him saying goodbye. But great, great voice. I mean, if you hear him sing a cappella, you could type in their live studio renditions of their songs during the COVID, lockdown. And mixed or mastered or not, his voice is phenomenal. He still sounds just absolutely great. So on to the last one.